2,300 grafts using follicular unit extraction hair transplant method. After seeing my hair, the surgeon said I will need about 2,300 grafts and cost about $15,000. I also wanted my hairline lowered a little because I have a kind of big forehead. Now I'm just curious because it's my first ever procedure, let alone hair transplant. Also, I live in Sacramento, California, and the doctor I met is in Santa Clara, California. Does anyone have any tips or helpful information this time for me? Hope these help.
Thank you for your question. You did a consultation with a surgeon who estimated that you need about 2,300 hair grafts to help you with your hair loss. And you also wrote that you want to lower your hairline. Well, in answering your question, I want to share with you how we approach hair loss in our practice. I've been doing hair transplantation for over 10 years, and I've had the unique opportunity to be very active in developing a new, more recent concept called hair regeneration. So I think I can help you understand a little bit more about the factors that are involved before you make a decision about moving forward with your transplant. So when someone comes to our practice and they are concerned about hair loss, we do several things as part of their initial evaluation. First, we want to know at what age did they start losing hair. The unfortunate reality is that when people start losing hair when they're younger, in their even late teens or early 20s, it tends to be a very rapidly progressing process. And unfortunately, a lot of times the same people who have this type of hair loss, particularly male pattern hair loss specifically, often don't respond very well to medical treatments such as minoxidil or finasteride. So age of onset and rate of progression are very important factors. You see, traditional hair transplant surgery, unfortunately, is associated with doctors who see the patient and want to sell a procedure and don't always consider the long-term consequences. In discussing the strategies of management for patients with hair loss, many hair transplant surgeons just think of it as a continuous process where they'll get the transplant 1 year, but as they progress, they'll need more transplantation. Now, although that may sound all right on the surface, here are the other factors that you have to take into account. Most importantly is your donor area. The donor area is the area in the back of the scalp where, whether it's male or female pattern hair loss, this hair never goes away. So you look at the most advanced male pattern hair loss and you see the area of the donor or the little band of hair. This area is considered genetically resistant. And at this point, it was considered, up to this point, I should say, that this area was resistant to the effects of dihydrotestosterone, or DHT. So the strategy has always been take hair from the donor, create grafts, and then transplant to the areas that need the grafts. But like a bank account, it is not unlimited. So you have to think strategically of where you place the hairs. Very often, if you do any research in hair transplant, people will keep their competition amongst transplant doctors goes towards numbers of grafts and cost per graft. And people keep comparing doctors in the way they compare the cost of a lot of other consumable items. But this is a distinctly different situation. If you have only so many hairs available for transplantation, You have to make your decisions very strategically. If you walk into any restaurant in the New York area where we practice in Manhattan and Long Island, you will see many men sitting at tables who look like they have plugs. And unfortunately, that's a very big negative to people's perception of hair transplantation. They wonder, why would anyone get plugs like that? Well, the reality is that most likely this individual had hair, and the hair plugs were placed in between those existing hairs. However, whether they chose not to take finasteride or whether they progressed despite taking finasteride, regardless, what ended up being left are the hair transplants and the grafts, and the normal hairs, the natural hairs, the native hairs have all disappeared. So this is something very, very important for you to consider. When you think about lowering your hairline, that is a very, very important strategy in terms of the number of grafts available. In round numbers, when you have a full head of hair, when you're a teenager, when you're in your 14, 15 years old, you have approximately 100,000 hairs. It is commonly understood in our field that when you first start noticing hair loss, you've already lost about 50% of your hair. Now, in a way that's good in that it takes almost 50% to get decent coverage, but you're at least noticing it. By the time people choose to have any kind of attention, they've lost a lot more. So now here we go from 100,000 hairs to what you're describing, let's say for example, is 2,300 grafts or 2,300 hairs. It is important to understand that this means that you can either concentrate them strategically or spread them out. From my experience, it tends to be less beneficial to spread them out too thinly or to try to create a lower hairline that is so much consistent with a much younger age that you end up losing a lot of your grafts that when you are ready for a second procedure, you don't have as many to harvest. So, strategy is extremely important and being realistic. So, again, understanding rate of progression, medical management, and think about how you'll look several years from now. In our practice, when someone young comes to us, we do an evaluation and we actually, in discussion, if the person is not interested in taking finasteride or is progressing despite taking finasteride. Finasteride is goes by the trade name Propecia. It's a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor. And this is the enzyme that inhibits the conversion of testosterone to dihydrotestosterone. A common myth is that men who are losing hair have too much testosterone. But actually, that's not true. It's really that their hair is genetically susceptible to the effects of dihydrotestosterone. What we offer many of our patients who come to us and first have a consultation about hair transplant is we offer a procedure we call hair regeneration. Now, hair regeneration is something that I've developed over the past couple of years where we use a material called extracellular matrix. This is a material that's derived from pig's bladder that is used for wound healing. It's a fascinating, almost accidental discovery that this material, which when placed on injured muscle will recruit adult stem cells to produce muscle. When it's placed on skin, it recruits adult stem cells to create skin. Now, although it's derived from pig bladder, it has nothing really pig about it in terms of the unique proteins, so that its material is able to be applied or used in multiple species. And what we have been able to do is use this material in combination with platelet-rich plasma in a specific way customized to individual patterns of hair loss. And we have been able to reverse thinning hair and restore the cells and signals that appear to be disrupted when a person has thinning hair. Now, because this was a clinical discovery, and what we're doing is based on clinical evaluation and follow-up, we see our patients at 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, a year, and beyond, and we've been able to help both male and female pattern hair loss, as well as a good percentage of patients who come to us with alopecia areata, as well as unusual processes such as systemic lupus. So this is a very different way of thinking about hair loss. In other words, what we believe we have been able to find is that, and the theory is, that stem cells that are naturally occurring in the area known as the dermal papilla that interact with another part of the hair follicle called the progenitor cells appear to be restored through this selective trauma or wound healing process that takes these hairs that were thinning and start restoring the active process of hair growth such that the hairs become thicker. Now, there are limitations. We're not able to restore all the hair, but we have been able to make such a remarkable difference for people who have progressive thinning such that when we treat someone with this hair regeneration system, what we'll do is we'll observe them for a year to a year and a half or beyond, and then if the patient still needs hair transplant, well, in many ways, it's almost like we've already done a very effective hair transplant without surgery because the thickening up of existing hairs covers more scalp. So when we see our patients for hair transplant after we've done the hair regeneration, then we're able to be very strategic with the placement of hairs to get better coverage. Now, some people come to us with some kind of a deadline, whether it's getting married or something like that, and we'll combine the hair regeneration with the transplant. So, in answering your question, I want you to ask yourself to summarize. How old are you? Where's the family pattern? If your family pattern, whether it's father, uncle, brothers, siblings, male members of your family, if they progress at a certain rate, then you have to think about where you'll be from whatever age you are now in a few years. And think about the number of grafts that you could actually realistically harvest from your donor area. And last but not least, investigate this procedure of hair regeneration using extracellular matrix and platelet-rich plasma. Learn more about your options so that you can make a strategic decision. So I hope that was helpful. And thank you for your question.